by fans, for fans, the Hog Style. And now, here's your host, Sean Conti.
Welcome to the Hog Style's post-game show, sent from the heavens, assembled in a lab, and brought to you by TicketClub.com. It's Dallas week, and we have a win to celebrate, so there's that, but not much else. How are you guys doing, Alex and Steve? Are you finally able to exhale after that nail-biting kick?
That's how happy I am.
It was a nail biter today.
Yeah, it certainly came down to the wire. Yes.
It was an exhausting game.
Yes. Okay, that's a good way to put it.
But I can put away my heavy drinking of defeat and go to the heavy drinking of victory. That's the good news.
Heavy drinking of victory is kind of the perfect way to put this game, my reaction to this game.
Yeah.
Because it was incredibly underwhelming. So there is the win. We've got to do our due diligence there and say good job, guys. But, Steve, do you want to hit us with the numbers so we can see just how bad this really was?
Yeah, I do. But I want to know, first of all, what's the difference between loss drinking and victory drinking, Alex?
I can explain.
I'm smiling.
Okay. There's no difference. That's what I thought. Maybe I'll have an extra sun kiss tonight to celebrate.
There you go, man. You got the win, so you got to celebrate. But it is a heavy, sad drink. You know what I'm saying? It's like you're not jazzed up.
Dude,
you're not ready for next week. You're just ready. You're just glad this is over. You know what I mean?
We got an NFC East win. I'll take
you're right.
it.
You're
you know,
right.
I don't care how it happened.
Yeah. I mean, look, it wasn't pretty. I'm with you. But W is a W, and we won off the glorious bounce off the, you know.
Yeah.
Field goal.
And one of us.
You got that doink sound that's just beautiful.
Classic, right?
And one of us got the prediction exactly right. I can't remember who it was. Somebody predicted 2017 win. So somebody out there, please let us know who it was, because one of us hit this exactly on the head.
We don't even know.
It wasn't me, because I thought they would lose.
It was either Sean or I think. I can't remember. I don't know. Okay, here's the stats. Alex Smith was 14 for 25, 178 yards, one touchdown, was sacked one time, quarterback rating of 91.8. Adrian Peterson, 24 carries, 99 yards, 4.1 yards per attempt with a long of 33. Alex Smith had 16 yards rushing himself. Capri Bibbs, 2 for 13. Samaje Perine, 2 carries to 2 yards. Capri Bibbs and Jordan Reed tied for most receiving yards. Both had 43. Capri Bibbs on 4 receptions, Jordan Reed on 2. Bibbs, of course, had the touchdown in the first half on the screen pass. Josh Doctson, 3 receptions, 42 yards on 6 targets. Maurice Harris, 3 catches, 22 yards on 3 targets. Michael Floyd, 1 reception on 20 yards on 3 targets. And Adrian Peterson had 1 catch for 8 yards in his own right. On defense, Zach Brown and Mason Foster tied for 9 tackles each. Brown 8 solo,
okay.
Foster 6. Josh Norman had 5 tackles.
There you go, Josh.
And Ryan Kerrigan had 2 sacks, including the tackle for a loss. And he had the big strip of Prescott in the end zone that
turnovers.
Ended up being a touchdown.
Turnovers, baby.
And yeah, that was such a key play. Everyone was going nuts. Right. You could just tell on social media. That was the play of the game, right?
Well, yeah, let's save that.
Probably.
In terms of Dallas, Prescott was 22 for 35, 273 yards, 96.5 quarterback rating, 1 touchdown. Elliott was 15 carries, 34 yards, or 2.3 yards per attempt. Prescott had 6 carries, 33 yards. Leading receiver was Michael Gallup, 3 receptions. He was the leading receiver on the game, 3 receptions, 81 yards, and a touchdown.
Nah, who cares?
Alan Hearns, 5 for 74. Cole Beasley, 7 catches, 56 yards. And it goes down from there. I'm not reading every single
blah,
one of those.
Blah, blah, blah. Fair enough.
No. Screw
blah,
up.
Blah, blah, blah. Fair enough.
Okay, I get the impression you guys are feeling a little bit better, more optimistic about this game than I am. I'm feeling kind of down on it.
Yeah.
It's one of those kind of downer wins for me. But I'll let you guys start. What are you feeling positive about from this game? Tell me something good about this offense, because that's what I'm particularly feeling bad about.
I'll tell you one of the good thing about the offense is that Adrian Peterson had the best game of the year against the Dallas Cowboys defense.
No, I understand that.
You know, he was 3 yards short of Chris Carson, but Carson did it on 32 carries. So, I mean, what we said in the pregame was that Peterson probably wasn't going to have a great rushing game. Well, he did, and that made a huge difference in the game. So that is one thing that was unexpected and good.
Oh, without a doubt, if Peterson doesn't have a good game, this is a loss. Well,
isn't
I mean,
that
you know,
every game
now,
this season, guys, if we're going to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, this team's one-dimensional right now. This is Adrian Peterson running the ball and Alex Smith just doing nothing.
Doing nothing.
I mean, that's what this team that's what this team is.
Exactly.
And you know, other teams have won the Super Bowl on that system though. So, I'm okay with you know, if you're going to play
Ravens
good defense and run the ball, you know, there's a worse formula in the NFL.
The Washington Redskins won a Super Bowl like that. I'd like to point out with a 33-year-old running back.
That
or 33-year-old
running back and a veteran quarterback at that point, not quite the same age.
Yeah, I mean, it's a different age. You know, I get that. It's a different era of football.
Absolutely.
But however we get the win is however we get the win. I don't want to be so negative right up front. So, I mean, that's the positive. I think another positive was that the wide receivers got more involved in the game. Again, Doxson, you know, had 6 targets. That's good. He made some good plays. Made some good catches.
Right.
That's good.
Let's be honest. Those 2 deep balls that they're credited as targets, those were nowhere close. He couldn't have caught either of them.
Probably true.
Yeah, I mean, Smith has been a big disappointment to me on his deep balls. He's just not been good at that.
Smith has been a big disappointment on his shallow balls, his mid-range balls.
I'm not going to hate on
just
him.
Just about everything.
No, I'm not going to hate on him too much. I, you know, doing our live tweeting thing, I see just tons of hate coming at Alex Smith. Look, he's not been terrible. Yes, he's not been as good as even I thought. But it's not like this guy is blowing games, okay?
Nah.
I mean, he's been competent. He's been decent. I refuse to bag on him too much. The one I fault him for the misses on the deep balls. I fault him for not sliding in bounds, for God's sakes. You know, there late in the fourth quarter. Why did you run out of bounds?
Yeah, that's a basic thing you do.
That was like a, you know, duh, what am I doing play. But I don't think this guy is some kind of horrible quarterback.
He's
Alex
not
Smith,
a horrible
this
quarterback,
is exactly
but
what he
this
is
not an offense that's going to survive in a postseason with this formula. This is not the age where you can go forward without a competent passing attack. Continued incompetence is what we've seen. There's no way we can keep up with an offense that, and we've seen offenses run, you know, up on us. Look at what the Saints did. We're not going to last in the postseason or further in this season with the offense performing this way. So I'm happy for the win, but that's where I'm.
No, you're probably right. I mean,
no, go ahead.
We're going to struggle against teams that are high powered on offense. Like Philadelphia is probably going to run it up on us. But,
I don't know. I mean,
yeah.
Let's stop with the postseason talk. It's, you know, game 6. We've got a long
time.
We have 4 wins. Let's wait till we get to 10 wins to even talk about postseason.
I don't even think
postseason.
We're going to make postseason, but that's not even where I'm coming from. I'm talking about the caliber of the team. I think it's a postseason caliber defense. It's not a postseason caliber offense.
I'm just not ready to toss this offense in the trash can. I mean, we're missing, you know, we're missing, you know, our best wide receiver, our 2 top wide receivers. You know, we're missing our third down back
today. Basically the same production. Look, I'm just trying to be real, guys. I'm not trying to be Debbie Downer.
I know you are. I'm not arguing with you about it. I'm not trying to argue with you about it. I just don't think that everybody needs to be quite so negative about Alex Smith. This is kind of who he is, guys.
You're right.
This is who he is.
It's not a surprise. And folks, at home, please don't get off me for
being Joe Montana. He's a solid quarterback who's going to put up decent stats. He's a solid quarterback. He's going to put up decent stats, but he's not Joe Montana. He's never been.
Yeah.
No. But, I mean, this is also why teams have kind of had him and been like, all right, who else can we get? You know, that's kind of been the mantra of Alex Smith. Who else can we get? You know,
exactly. He's not going to
You can
do
use
anything.
Him as a placeholder for this year and next year, but you better have a plan for year 3.
Exactly.
That's kind of where I am.
A relatively competent guy. He's not going to do anything flashy for you. There you go. You're right. It's not a surprise. This is what he's always been. This is what he is on this team. It's just I watched this, and there was a point at which the announcers – this was in the fourth quarter. So the game's getting close to – you know, we're getting close to losing it. Everyone's holding their breath. And there's
right.
The announcer goes, okay, so, yep, Washington lines up. Yep, so that's going to be a run. And 1-yard loss. And I think that just kind of says it. So then they run twice. They can't get anything going on first and second down. Then it's an obvious passing situation. It doesn't work. I'm just noting on how the announcers are picking up on exactly what we're going to do from first down. They're able to call first down, second down, and third down plays. That's just not a good look.
Sure.
That's not a good look.
Well, I'd also like to make one thing clear here. The offense wasn't the reason why the game was close, okay? I mean, the reason why the game was close is that the Redskins' defense crapped the bed in the fourth quarter. and all of a sudden let the Cowboy offense run up and down the field. That is why the Cowboys were in this game. It was not the fault of the offense. Yes, Alex Smith could have done better. Shoot him, hang him, you know, let's, you know, tar and feather him, drive him out to put him out to sea with a big rock tied to his chest. I get that. But the fact of the matter is that the defense utterly quit. They didn't quit. They failed. They utterly failed late in the fourth quarter. They gave up a first down on a 4th and 13. They gave up a first down on a 3rd and 10 on a key drive. Yeah. And frankly, they got a little bit lucky. You know, and the defense is the fault, not the offense.
Well, let's,
against the top, one of the top-rated defenses in the league.
Yeah.
You know, the offense wasn't going to put up 30 points.
Probably not. So let's talk about that actually a little bit. And I know we're jumping around a little bit, but hell, it's Dallas week. We can just throw the rule book to the wind this week. What happened there in the fourth quarter? And
right.
Why do you see a complete turnaround? Because I agree with you completely, Steve. It was like they had them stopped. They had Dallas's number, and then you give it up, you know, you start letting major.
Right.
So what is that? Is that just like a resurgence of this dreaded prevent defense that never prevents anything? Is that what this is?
It's playing the clock is what it is. And I don't mind coaches who play the clock when you're up 10, but you can't, you know, like let them get one or two first downs so that they're running the clock a little bit on their side. That's fine. But when you get towards that like midfield section, you got to clamp down more, and that's what the Redskins don't do. They continue to play soft after they get past the 50, and that's a problem.
If I can interject some X's and O's
please
here,
do. We don't have Jamal.
Yeah,
got
I think.
Gotta do.
Yeah, well, number one, this is not what a prevent defense is. Okay, what a prevent defense is less drop the entire secondary back like 15 yards, give them everything
right
underneath to stop the deep ball. That is not what we were doing. What we were doing here, they were blitzing. They blitzed Josh Harvey Clemens several times.
Yeah,
they were
they
trying
did
to put tons and tons of pressure on Dak Prescott by bringing that extra linebacker. And what was happening was is Dak was all the secondary was giving him open man. That's what happened.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a prevent defense. This is a failure of the secondary, combined with the defensive front seven just barely couldn't get there enough. And then they let Prescott run wild. They gave him an open rushing lane twice, and one was called
well,
back.
But to be
that's
fair, they gave him open rushing lanes down the middle of the field where that runs the clock. That's what they were.
Yeah, but
their
what
goal
was the
is
key
to keep things
game
from happening on the sidelines. That was the
what
whole
was
point.
What was the key to this game? One of the keys to this game, we said, is you cannot give Dak Prescott room to run.
Oh, yeah. I understand that. But I'm just also saying there were 3 minutes left. They were trying to get that clock down to under 2 minutes on that one drive where they ended up scoring a touchdown. And they got to, what, 130? And then the Cowboys had 130 left. The problem was the whole they didn't make them spend any timeouts or anything like that on defense.
Yeah.
You got to kind of push them a little harder than that.
I just strongly disagree with you guys out there who are saying, why are the Redskins playing prevent defense? You know, because I saw it on Twitter. We were following our Twitter feed, saw that. And that's just not what a prevent defense is, people.
That's not prevent.
No, but I think where people are coming from with that is just that the coverage was soft. It appeared to be soft zone coverage towards the end, which I think people were confused about because they were just picking us apart.
It was the soft zone coverage, and it was kind of empty out the middle, so if they get anything, it's in the middle. That's what they were doing.
So that, I mean, that this
is because they were bringing the backers, and you could have dropped Josh Harvey Clemens back into coverage, put the seventh man in coverage,
right,
and they just weren't doing that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Have one guy in the middle of the field, and that totally changes what they're doing.
Yeah. So that's what I think, I mean, in Dallas' offense just all of a sudden started to execute better than they had, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, they kind of came up big under pressure, and the Redskins' defense didn't. Now, a win is a win. You know, I don't want to be too negative because we need to be positive about this.
Yeah, 4-2.
We beat the Dallas Cowboys for the first time in 5 games.
Yeah, Jesus.
You know, and
yeah,
they're in first place in the division. So I will take a win however we get it, particularly in a
4-2 puts us in a very good spot right now. That's
exactly
what we need to realize.
Better spot than I particularly.
And we have a favorable schedule going forward.
The Carolina Panthers did their job and beat the Eagles. You know,
the
Giants have sucked. I mean, the Redskins are in the power position here, and we should be happy that happened. You know, I don't want to be
absolutely
too negative. A win is a win is a
that
win.
That is, and the Eagles and some other mm-hmm division teams have a brutal slate coming up here.
Yeah.
So you're right. I think we're in first place in the division, and I think we're going to stick there for a while. I have my concerns when I see performances like this.
We're going to have to ride AP. I mean, AP's the bellwether.
Until Chris Thompson is healthy again, I mean, who else do we got? You know, like,
he's the Hall of Famer. I mean, we should be riding him.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I agree with that. But I'm just saying Chris Thompson's another, probably our second best weapon after him. Jordan Reed's a shell of whatever he was. You know, he's been
Jordan
good for
Reed's
two, three catches. Yeah.
You know, I don't know why.
I don't understand that.
Yeah, so. I don't know why he's not getting 10 targets a game. You know,
I don't think he's a shell of himself,
and ability-wise, he's shown to have his tremendous hands. He's gotten open. He's
healthy. That's not fair for me to say it's on him. I think it's as much on Smith as anybody.
I don't think he's got just a good connection with Smith. Is the psychic mind?
I don't think anybody does.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Who does right now? I don't know about you guys.
I do notice that they're...
Sorry, I was just going to make an extracurricular comment, which is, I don't know about you guys, but it looked like there was some tension between AP and Smith a couple times on the sideline today. I don't know if you guys picked that up, but it looked like they were frustrated with each other a couple times.
That I didn't know. I did notice that. That's a good pickup.
I didn't.
I was about to say was, they've been keeping – Jordan Reed has been rotating in and out more than he has in recent years, I think, and that's probably an attempt to keep him healthy since they have another quality tight end in Vernon Davis. And Jeremy Sprinkle got some targets
today.
That's right. You know, Jeremy Sprinkle almost had the game-sealing touchdown. That was a bad pass from Smith,
that's right.
No doubt.
Yeah.
You know, that would have been the touchdown. That would have kind of put the game out of reach. And so they're bringing Sprinkle into the game more, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and he's a good run blocker, so it makes sense for what they're doing. So I'm speaking just to – I know we got to get to defense, but how many plays did we run on offense that were runs out of shotgun this week? It felt like every single run was some kind of shotgun sweep or – you know, something along those lines.
Well, a lot of those sweeps you're talking about were actually college-style option plays.
Yeah. It was like a toss out on the run. Yeah,
that's,
I noticed that too.
That is a traditional option that a ton of college teams runs. We did it at least three times that I noticed.
Yep. I think we had it right on three. Sean Lee busted up one.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's something else. But
it felt like that was the entire offense was that outside run.
Yeah. That,
well, when the entire offense.
That was something else that the announcers and people online were picking up on. And we're talking about how Adrian Peterson hasn't spent much time doing that, having all those plays and all those options out of shotgun. But he does now. And it's just interesting to see him do it. So that's something else people were picking up on. Good call.
Can I say how much I hate listening to Tony Romo call these games?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Mark Bullock disagreed. Mark Bullock responded to my tweet about Romo and disagreed with me. And so Bullock can have his opinion. That's fine. We love him no matter what
he
says.
What
did he say? I just said, you know, Tony Romo's a homer and I'm tired of listening to him. And Mark's response was that he was being pretty fair to the Redskins. My problem wasn't so much that I disagreed with his analysis of the Redskins, is that he spent 95% of his time talking about the Dallas Cowboys. And he was basically, you know, emotionally crushed there at the end of the game. So I just don't think – I hate Tony Romo.
Yeah.
Move on. Let's move on. I hate Tony Romo at the end.
I respect that. Okay.
Yeah. I hate Aikman. I hate Romo. I hate Witten. I hate Moose
guys.
Johnson.
I in particular hate Tony Romo and his beady little eyes, and I hate Tony Romo.
Oh, Steve. Fenty.
Yeah. He can't ever shave cleanly. What's going on there?
I think he just doesn't grow a beard cleanly is what it more is.
That might be it too. I can't judge a man
for
that.
That's what female hormones pills will do.
Good to know. You heard it here first. All right. Before we move on, because like Alex said, we should talk about defense because, you know, it's plenty to talk about there. But let me just ask you guys about offense. Last question. Is the offense playing to its potential? In other words, can you reasonably expect more out of this offense than you're seeing right now? Or is there still something missing? They're not playing to that potential.
We're missing our top three. Our top two pass catchers and our third down back.
Do you think their presence today would have made a huge difference?
Would have made a difference, for sure. I mean, if you have the guy you paid $40 million to be the Z receiver in there, yeah, of course it would have made a difference. And if you have the top 10 in the NFL slot receiver in there, sure it would have made a difference.
Okay.
I would put it this way. What did Smith get, 174 or something?
Yes,
178.
Yeah, all right. That's probably closer to 230 with those guys. So, you know, like, it's worth probably another 50, 60 yards, another field goal, maybe another touchdown.
Which could be huge.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Michael Floyd, God bless. Michael Floyd, God bless him. I mean, he's a pro. and all that, but he had three right. targets today. You know, somebody right. there was somebody named Jihu Chesson that was on the active roster today. I mean, Mr. and Mrs. Chesson probably didn't know that their son was out there, you know?
Look at me now, Mom.
He got playing time, you know, at least on special yeah. teams he did. So, I mean.
Number 16, right, I think.
He was number 16. I mean, I don't know about the yardage specifically, but I agree with Alex in principle that it was worth – More passing yardage. That
I'm just trying to quantify yeah. it. You know
Which
what I mean?
So hard to
yeah,
do.
I don't know. Yeah,
you
know,
I'm with you. Yeah. I'm with you.
Yes.
Yeah. I think the passing game would have been more open because also, if you want again X's and O's here, Paul Richardson is speedy. You know, so yeah. you have to think that hopefully, I mean, the point of bringing him in is that he was kind of D-Jack's light with a splattering of Pierre Garçon.
Something
in.
They got to respect.
And if you have that. Yeah, if you have right. that, you know, is there does the offense open up more if you have him running nine
yeah.
routes?
No, it makes him,
you know.
If you have Crowder open 5 yards deep on most plays, is Alex Smith running for his life five times
there
this
you
game?
Go. That's, yeah. There you go. Perfect. I like that. I, for the most part, I agree with you. All right, let's do defense then. Obviously, great performance. We, except for, as Steve noted, clearly think, you know, we had issues there at the very end of the game. But for the most part, this was a team, Dallas, that came in here having scored 40-some points last week. That was not the case this week. Came out strong. Let's talk defense. Who were the was the standout?
But before we you know get too far, let's also note that Dallas had like 8 points in one game this year. They had
you're right.
They've had a lot of bad performances
have
on
not
offense.
Won on
so
the, on the road a single time yet?
No, they haven't. But our defense really did dominate, especially the front seven. I think we can all agree that you know containing Zeke is not an easy task for any
That's
defense,
right.
and they did it better than anybody
right.
this week. So. You know, hats off to the front seven for
yeah,
that.
And Steve,
yeah, I mean, that was the key.
My eyes deceived me, Steve. What was his yard total at the end of the game?
He had 34 yards.
My eyes don't deceive
34
me.
Yards yeah. on 15 carries. No, your eyes didn't.
And almost all that was in the second half.
Yeah, and I mean, that was, you know, the biggest key to the game that I put in my written game preview, and I think we all pretty much yeah. agreed in the podcast preview, stopping Zeke was job number one. You know, what yeah. we all agreed, and at least what I put in writing, was that if you stop Zeke, the best way to win is – I'm not going to call him Zeke. I hate that name. If we stop Elliott and try to and keep Prescott in the pocket and let him beat you with his arm, and that's exactly what happened, with the exception of the three times they let Prescott get out of the pocket and run straight down the field unchallenged. That's pretty much what happened, and they won the game because
yeah.
of it.
Yeah, and by the way, when we said stop Zeke, I would have been happy if they'd kept him to like 80 yards. Yeah. So 30-something is a really great
yeah.
day.
I mean, it's about efficiency for me, you know, because he yeah. could have gotten 80 yards, but if he'd done it on 30 carries, I can live with that. You know, he had 15 carries. He was ineffective. Only had
right.
34 yards. He was unable to keep, you know. They
were hitting him in the backfield a lot.
Yeah, they were hitting him in the backfield a lot. He wasn't taking control of drives like he's done over and over and over again. He's done it to
yeah.
us a million times, it seems like. And they didn't do that. And so that we really took the defensive front seven took a weapon away from the Dallas Cowboys today. And that was a huge reason why they won the game, I think.
It was. I think if you take that and then, you know, you factor in, what did we have, two turnovers or just the one
two.
Turnover?
Two turnovers.
Two. You know, like, two turnovers is huge in a game like this. A
yeah.
defensive game, you know, whoever wins the turnover battle is usually going to win a game like this, and that's
DJ
what happened.
DJ Swearinger came with a toe that's a bit too big from getting a third turnover, you know, there early
yeah.
in the game.
Although that worked out in our favor because the punt wasn't good. You know, so that worked out.
Yeah, that's
out.
True. Yeah, if it would have been worse. We didn't score any points anyway, you know, off turnovers. So I don't think we did.
Yeah.
No, I don't think.
Yeah.
Well, obviously we did on the one turnover. That was a fumble
well, yeah,
for
yeah,
a touchdown.
I meant on the ones that, yeah, beyond
yeah,
that
yeah.
one.
Right.
And the other thing here is that the other key we said is you can't let Cole Beasley beat you.
Yeah, he
was
their
right.
best receiver. He was a non-factor for the most part.
Yeah, he had 7 catches. I was not expecting Michael Gallup. I got to admit, I totally overlooked Michael Gallup. I didn't know he was as good as he was. He just made Greg Stroman look like a pathetic loser there on that one play.
Well, to be fair, you know, Greg Stroman's starting on the outside for us, which is not something we should be doing right now. I mean,
no,
you know, that's a plan
yeah.
C kind of thing.
It's a plan F is what it is.
Right. Yeah, yeah, we're no stranger to those.
Yeah. So anyway.
Beasley.
Yeah. I was not ready for Michael Gallup to do what he did. And the announcers, to their credit, made note of the fact that Gallup has been improving. And so I think he's probably someone to watch next time we play him is Michael Gallup.
Fair enough.
Sure.
To go back a little bit to what we were just talking about the guys up front. Key to the game, yep, stopping Zeke totally. Key to the game also stopping Prescott from running. And by the way, almost knocked his head off at one point. We should talk about that at least once on the show before we go. That was Stroman, right?
Well, and that was Stroman, too, wasn't that? Yeah.
That nearly knocked his clock off. But no, the point is, it seems like we get good pressure. I don't know if it's a function of the fact that we've faced a lot of escapable quarterbacks, but it seems like we don't always, you know, hit pay dirt with the sacks, although we had some luck today. But for the most part, the guys up front, excellent job on Zeke and Prescott. I mean, that's where it started. And ended with this game and stopping Dallas. So it's just worth noting, again, up the guys up front. They did it.
I'm wondering if Greg Stroman's going to get fined for that hit on Prescott.
They didn't. I don't think so.
I don't think so. That was Prescott's the one who dove head first into his shoulder.
I'm with you. I'm with you, dude. Yeah. I just mean, you know, in today's, you know, wimpified NFL, I mean, he got hit right in the helmet. You know, so Stroman needs to, like, lace his wallet into his pants or something.
Well, it wasn't helmet to helmet at all. I mean, you know, it was clearly helmet hit shoulder.
But it looked like it was. That's Prescott, why they were, I think, talking about it at first, reacting to it. It looked. Yeah.
And I also think that the Dallas Cowboy medical staff must have looked the other way when, you know, Dak was trying to count backwards from 10 and, you know, missed.
And started staring at the screen in the middle of it. Yeah. He clearly had something going on.
Yeah.
Probably shouldn't have played a series.
Yeah, if anyone should get fined, it should be them. They should get fined for putting him out there when he's obviously got a couple screws loose.
Yeah.
All right, so should we mention again? I know we talked about it a little up front, but my goodness, it all came down to that final kick. 52 yards, I think it was, they said, right?
52.
52 yards. That would have been good from 51 yards. You know, it clanged off the uprights. The illegal motion or the false start penalty there
long snapper, yes.
Yeah, that cost Dallas the game. Yeah. At least it cost them a tie, and it handed them the loss, because if they'd kicked out from 47, it would have definitely been good.
And Steve and I were saying right before we started recording, but we should say again, I think he and I are in agreement that if that game had gone into overtime, it probably would have been a loss with just the momentum and the way things were going at that point.
Agreed. Oh, yeah. I that's how I felt, too.
Yeah, it was a slam dunk.
Like, you could have gotten lucky on a win. Maybe you get someone gets free, you get a touchdown easy, but that's about it.
It would have required a little bit of luck, exactly. All right. Yeah. Well, we're at about 28 minutes. Do we have any lingering thoughts about the game we want to get out before we do game balls on Dallas Week? Dallas Week game balls?
Yeah, my lingering thought here is I hope, if for all you guys out there listening, it's okay to criticize the quarterback, but he's not as bad as you guys think. Remember how many weapons were missing, and remember what was working on offense. What was working on offense was the run game.
Right.
We did spread the ball around more to the right wide receivers, you know, who were like at this point the seventh string wide receiver, you know, because four of them are gone. So I don't think Alex Smith is as bad as you people out there are saying. You know,
fair enough.
Well, my closing thought is about the wide receivers. There was a rumor just before this game that both the Cowboys and the Redskins had contacted Oakland about trading for their wide receiver they're trying to get rid of, Cooper?
Cooper.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm still not sold on that idea, but it's interesting that both these teams are talking to Oakland about that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? I'm going to keep my eye on that.
It's appropriate. I mean, the Redskins are doing their due diligence. I don't blame them for that. I mean, I would blame them if they gave up some crazy, you know, let's give them a first round,
like a first rounder or a second rounder. Yeah, I would not be down with that. But you know, if somehow we do that for like a fifth rounder, I'm okay.
He started in Oakland, right? Cooper. Yeah,
Cooper.
And
he's
this is like his third year, maybe second or third year.
Yeah, he's 24 or something.
He's young stuff. All right. All right, lingering thoughts. My lingering thought is, God, I hope you guys listening at home don't think I'm a huge jerk for the way I started this, because I feel like it now.
Sean, you are a huge jerk for the way you started this.
And for other reasons, but today it's for that reason. I don't actually mean to be that negative. I'm, of course, very happy and satisfied with the win. It's a little concerning to win by, you know, a self-inflicted wound by the Cowboys at the end that moves them back out of field goal range. You can only complain so much. So, no, we just got to keep it up with that run game, and you just got to do what you can to keep that thing going, because I shudder to think, and we've seen it a couple times already, what happens when we don't have it. But anyways, moving on from there, let's do some game balls, guys. What do you think?
Let's do it.
All right. I guess I can go first this week. I don't know why. I don't really want to. But, hey, let's do it. I'm going to go Capri Bibbs on offense. So, now, I probably should give it to Peterson for another 99-yard performance, but Bibbs may not have another chance. So I'm going to give it to Bibbs this week. 43 yards in the touchdown. Kind of got lucky on that little screen pass type of thing there. But, hell, he got it. Showed some serious speed. So he gets it for me. But still no, actually, we didn't mention this, still no first half touchdowns from Alex Smith this season, or second half touchdowns from Alex Smith.
Second half, yeah. That would be 11 games in a row.
11 games in a row.
The 10 games in a row was touchdowns in the third quarter. So that goes on, and yeah, they utterly failed in the second half of each of these games in that regard.
Disappointing, man. Disappointing.
Yes.
Okay, on the old defense, a couple options today. Tempted to go Kerrion with the two sacks.
Okay.
And that's what I'll do.
I mean, one's a strip fumble.
I mean, yeah, he's got the play of the game, like you said, Alex, and also been a little quiet this season. He's had an impact, but hasn't gotten those sacks yet, so got two today. I'm feeling it. Bibbs and Kerrion get my game balls.
All right. Alex, you want to go next? You want me to go?
No, I'll go. Right. You know, offense, it's kind of not much going on. I appreciate that you gave one to Bibbs, but I'm going to go with the obvious answer, and that's Peterson. Fair. You know, he's really the only one who did yeoman's effort today on offense. So AP gets my offensive ball. And on defense, there are a couple options, like we were talking about. Just to spice things up, since you went Kerrion, I'll go DJ Swearinger.
I like it. I'm giving Alex the rock odd symbol right now. You can't see it at home, but that's what I'm doing. I like it.
Right.
Listen, the dude is the heart and soul of the defense. Yeah. You know, there's no doubt about that.
Yeah, emotional leader, without question.
Yeah. I'm on offense. I mean, I hate to be the same, but, I mean, to me, Adrian Peterson, there's only one option on offense, and it was him. You know,
no one really impressed. That's the problem.
Well, he impressed me. I mean, he did way better than I thought he would do against this stingy
Dallas.
Sorry,
I should say no one else really impressed.
I mean, he did way better than I thought he would do against the stingy Dallas defense. You know, he averaged over 4 yards a carry, and that's all you can ask against the number two rated, you know, rush defense in the league. So that's my game ball on offense. On defense, I'm gonna give Preston Smith a little love.
Nice.
Okay.
Because Preston got a touchdown. You know, he was there. He was able to make the play. You know, he made the key touchdown.
Drew
the game.
A holding penalty so, at one point early in the game, I think.
He was getting pressure all game long.
Yeah, and he got a quarterback hit. That's good. So it may be the only time only chance I have to give Preston some love. So Adrian Peterson and Preston.
That's a subtle game ball, Steve. I like it. That's a good one. That's good.
Yeah, a little bit of a deep cut. That's cool.
There you go.
I've been so focused on Dallas week. Who do we even play next week, guys?
Giants, buddy.
I hate the Giants.
Giants.
God, you should have said anything other than that, man. God, I hate the Giants. Okay, well, that'll be it.
Well, the question really to me is it going to be a big letdown game?
Yeah, that would be the question. That would be the question. Well, yeah.
We'll save that for the next show.
Yeah,
we got plenty to talk about there.
People need to get healthy. Let's just preview next week and say people need to get healthy.
Yeah, and Peterson needs to stop accumulating injuries.
That.
He's got like three lingering injuries right now, doesn't he? Shoulder, ankle, and like brain or something.
Speaking of that, injuries. The only major one was Adrian. It was Fabian Moreau there at the end of close to the end of the game. He went out. We're not sure about his status. You know,
looked like a helmet issue, like he got hit in the head or something.
We don't know right now, so we'll give you more on that once we get it. And then Preston Smith went out early in the game with an owie. He's obviously fine. So that's injuries. So keep an eye out on Moreau. He's going to join.
Did you just say owie?
I did. He got an owie. It was an owie. You know, it was an owie. For a pro football player, it was an owie. For you and I, that would sideline us for a week. For him, it was an owie.
I'd already be on the phone with OSHA if that was if that was me. All right.
Affleck.
Exactly. We'll leave it there. Like we said, we got Giants preview coming up, written and podcast form. You got something else, Steve?
Can I give an – I just want to give an honorary game ball to Greg Stroman for hitting Dak Prescott.
Yeah, that was badass.
Matter of fact, we're going to take a pool out there for you guys out there. We'll start a GoFundMe. You know, for every time we get a good hit on a quarterback's head, we're going to give the players some money.
Rip Prescott. How about that? I like it.
Yeah. We're not really going to do that.
Don't add us with that because we're not going to do it.
Can we call it the Greg Williams pool
Greg Williams,
or something?
Yeah, the Greg Williams Fund. We're going to call it the Greg Williams Fund. The Gurr Williams Fund.
Yeah, we'll definitely squander those funds. All right. All right, we'll leave it there, folks. We'll see you next time. Take care.